I think we are live now. So hi, I'm Shashi, and today we have Soham Mukherjee. So Soham, can you tell me something about yourself?
Sure. Hello, I'm Soham Mukherjee. I'm currently in my final year at Jadavpur University studying computer science and engineering. In my summers, like last summer, I interned with D. Shaw India, and then I got a PPO from there. And then recently, I cracked Shopee interview for Shopee Singapore and got an offer from them as well. So yeah, that's about me. And I'm also a 6-star coder at Codechef. Yeah, so that's basically it.
Yeah, so we have shared his LinkedIn profile in the video description section. You can explore that to know more about him. Okay, so I'll start with your interview experience of Disha. Like, how many rounds did you have, and how did you crack those rounds?
Yeah, sure. So in D Shaw we had one coding round. Like D Shaw visited our campus for placements, and there I got an internship offer from them.
You
So
can be a
D
little
Shaw
louder.
was
You can,
sorry, I can be a loud bit loud.
yeah,
Yeah,
that's
okay.
fine.
So in D Shaw there were 3 rounds. First round was online coding round, which had one coding question and many MCQs. Like MCQs can be from anything. It's not like just basic C++ or algorithms, but rather it can be from C, C++, OS, DBMS, networks, some maybe GK on computer itself, computer science itself, and that's all. Then and there was one coding question, obviously. And then if you crack that, like if you get like they shortlisted around 15 of us, and then we had our technical rounds. So the first technical round was mostly project discussion, like what I worked on till now, and then they placed some DSRGO questions, which I answered. And then that went super, very good. And then there was the second technical round, and in which I was asked questions on operating systems and some of computer organization, like caches and stuff. So that was like that time I didn't have that much experience, and they also understood that. So I was able to answer some of it, but then not all of it. But then overall, it was a decent interview as well. Like at last, they placed some DSRGO questions, and I was able to answer them as well. So overall, it went decently the second round, and then finally, they shortlisted two of us, myself from CSE department and another guy from IT department, and then they gave us the internship offer.
Okay, that's great. Okay, so before going to the Shopee interview, I just want to take one question from the chat, which is, can you tell about your ICPC experience?
ICPC, okay. So ICPC is like, so I went to ICPC regionals for 2 times, 2017 and 2019. So in 2017, it was more experimental kind. Like I just started competitive programming. I was not that good, but I was good enough. So I got shortlisted. Like I came third from my college and got shortlisted for one of the regionals, that is Gwalior. There we went, and due to a lack of experience, we actually failed miserably. Like not miserably, but then we didn't have a very decent rank. But like it was around 60 or 70 out of 100. So that was okay. So we actually took it in a more sporting way. Then for the second time, we went in 2019. And this time, so I was experienced one, but then the other two teammates were like it was first time for them. So one is from third year and one is from second year. So the three of us went there in Amritapuri. And then in Amritapuri as well, we couldn't perform decently. But then we were also shortlisted for Kanpur, but due to like there was some problem going on in Kanpur region that time. So my parents were very supportive about me going to Kanpur. So we had to just be satisfied with one of the regionals. And then it was okay, but then it was not very great. We could have done, like, we learned some things we could have done better in Kanpur regionals. But I really hope that those two guys are really awesome and they'll be like doing their best in the next year. So I hope for that, really hope for that.
Again, one very basic question is C language good for computer coding?
C language is good as in for a beginner, you can go for C, but then eventually you have to switch to C++, Java or Python, because means I would prefer C++, because obviously there are certain benefits of C++, but then that's because the rich libraries, template libraries that you get, like they already have inbuilt functional, like inbuilt data structures and algorithms as well, and then that would be helpful. Like in C, you have to implement them by yourself, and which is like kind of very difficult. It's not actually recommended. So better learn C++ or Python or something, Java or something like that, and then you should actually like do great.
Okay. Yeah. So can you tell from beginning, like how to get internship at companies like Disha?
Yeah, sure. So thing is that.
So you can be a little louder, so you can simply.
Sure. Yeah. So thing is that for company getting interviews in companies.
Your voice is low, so can you?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, now it's good.
Let me just check the audio.
Yeah, now it's good. Now it's good.
Okay, now it's good. Cool. So, thing is that when you are actually applying for companies, a good thing is having some background in competitive programming, because almost all companies will focus on that. Like they will test your data structure algorithm skills for sure. Like the online round will be based on data structures and algorithms and maybe some MCQs. Then in interviews, also technical interviews as well, they might ask you questions on data structure algorithm. Like most companies like Microsoft, Amazon and Google would ask you questions from data structure algorithms. Some companies like Shaw would ask some technical questions as well, like from CS fundamentals like OS and networks. But then it's always better, like in your best interest, to actually focus on a bit of competitive programming. You don't have to be great, but then it shouldn't be like you are completely neglecting competitive programming. So in case you are doing, like you should have some experience in competitive programming, and then you should actually, before your interviews, you should actually spend some time on sites like Geeks for Geeks and LeetCode, because there are certain companies who would actually like some companies if you're lucky enough, you might get some common questions from them. Like and in Geeks for Geeks, you can actually get many interview experiences as well. So you should go through them properly before actually appearing for an interview, just to get an idea like what you can expect from their side. Like it shouldn't be like you're going out blank there and you don't have any prior experience knowledge about what you can expect from their side, and that's like that's not a very big advantage for you. So if you know something from beforehand, then it will be advantageous for you, and then you actually can't just expect anything. Like you can't just like make any expectations that I won't be asked questions from CS fundamentals or so it's better to be prepared for everything.
Okay.
I guess so. Yeah. Just study everything. Also, like if you are going for, it's about internship. But then, if you are going for, FTs, then system design is also important sometimes.
Okay. So, is Python good for CP?
Python is you can actually use Python for CP. Like it has also all the necessary features you need. But then. It depends. Like Python is a bit slower, as you might already know. Okay. Then, online judges, they like where they will conduct the test, they might not actually might forget to like give a like proper time limit for Python. So it's always in your best interest to switch to C++. Like most of the competitive programmers use C++. But then obviously you can, if you are very comfortable with Python, then you might stick with Python. Like that won't be a big problem, I guess. Like I didn't see anyone actually facing problem in interviews because of Python.
Okay. One question from Ramit is, how many days required to crack coding of Disha?
How many days? Technically speaking, I didn't, like I prepared for one night for the interviews, because just the night before, like I wasn't sure, like we had Microsoft and Disha on the same day, the online round on the same day, and I actually cleared both of them. But then Disha, like I thought about like trying for Microsoft, because like Disha, I heard that they were like pretty, like it's pretty hard to crack their interviews. So, and I also didn't expect to get in, like crack the first round itself, because it contained MCQs, which I was terrible at, but then somehow I managed anyways. So So I was just preparing for Microsoft, and I actually prepared from Geeks for Geeks for a long time. Like for during my summer break, I was actually preparing for Geeks for Geeks, and then I would say that for TV show, I actually just prepared the night before I had my interview. I just called up one of my friends. Like his father is also in an IT company, so I just had a chat with his father about how to handle questions like why should we, like you should be prepared with these kind of questions, like why should we hire you, or why do you think you are a good fit for the company, something like that. So you should be very well prepared. Like you have to highlight your strengths there. And always in an interview, what you should do is you should always deviate them. Like they can ask you many things, but your target should be always deviating them towards your strength, not your weakness. So like I knew OS was my weakness. So they were trying to ask me from Linux kernels and then Windows. Then I just said that I don't have much idea because I'm currently in my second year. You can't just expect someone to know a lot about OS. So I just said that I don't have much idea. So if you can just ask me from something else. So they just agreed to that and they switched the topic instantly.
Okay.
So it's always be honest, and it's always in your best interest to focus on what your strengths are rather than your weakness. Don't answer something wrong, like that's very bad.
Okay, see, I mean, he was already a six-star coder, so he, I don't think he needed preparation to crack the coding round of Disha. So he's just keeping that portion, right? So, I mean, don't assume that you can crack the coding round of Disha in one.
That's what I said. Like I prepared Geeks for the summer. Like summer break, I prepared. But then, if you are not into competitive programming, then you should give some time. Like you should try solving as many problems as you can. Like maybe 2-3 months is good, or 4-5 months is good enough. Like you should be. Like if you are not into CP, right? I already had a confidence that I know CP. So if they ask me something that I don't know, I can think on like that point of time itself. So if you're not having that confidence, I would suggest you to just practice a bit.
Okay. So for programming language, you talked about C, you talked about C++, you talked about Python. What about Java? I mean, can someone use Java for computing?
So I am not very comfortable myself with Java because I never used Java that much because I'm from a CBSE background. So we are taught C++ in class 11 and 12. And then I stuck with that. So Java is good, is decent, but yeah, Java, like in Java, there are certain advantages over C++, like the string handling and part is really good in Java, but then C++ is better because C++ is much, much faster. So the exact problem that you would face with Python, you might face with Java as well. So in Java, there are like lots of stuff going on, converting to object code and stuff. So it's pretty slow compared to C++. So yeah, you might face the same problem sometime. But then it's okay. Like if you're preparing for interviews, it's okay to be like continuing with Java or Python. But then if you're looking towards you are going towards CP, then I would suggest you to you might actually focus on C++ a bit more.
Okay. Again, very genuine question is how to be a six-star coder. And don't say I just did it in one night preparation.
No. Obviously not. So initially when I started, like I started in my second year, I was already a bit late. So initially I wasn't able to.
You started in the second year and you were late.
Yeah. Many people start from first year. Like I could have started from first year itself. But then I started from second year, and by the end of second year, I was a six-star coder.
Mm-hmm.
So thing is that, actually not second year, I started in February 2017. And
okay.
Then by December 2017, I was six-star coder. Like it's first year, second semester, and then second year, first semester in, something like that. So anyways, I was a six-star within 1 year, but then the thing is that for the first few months, like first 1 or 2 months, I was just able to solve. I used to solve CodeChef a lot, but then I was just able to solve only 1 or 2 problems, not more than that. But then I constantly kept on learning. I absorbed the problems. Like after, that's very important. Like whenever you appear in a contest, you are not able to solve some problems, you should actually look into the editorials. Like you already have tried, right? You are trying for 10 days, you aren't able to solve. So that means you can't solve in the next 10 days as well, because there is something missing in your knowledge. There is something missing in your knowledge. So you should actually look into the problems, editorials. There are pretty nice editorials, and you should actually look into the prerequisites. You should learn all of them and then try the problem again. If you are still unable to look into the solution, like quick explanation maybe, and then try, in case you are still not able to, you should look into the full solution and like full editorial, and then you can try it. But upsolving is very important. Like with upsolve, like I upsolved all the problems like which I couldn't solve, and I learned about a lot of things. Like I learned about tries, I learned about HLD, I learned about 3DP, I learned about many other things, so SDP, many other stuff. So pretty advanced stuff. So by the end of 2017, I was able to solve. Like that time, there was no deep one and deep two in code shift. So there was a single long challenge, and it was around 10 questions. There were around 10 questions, and I was able to solve 7 to 8 of them by the end of 2017. So that's how you should, like what I did was I practiced a lot. Like I literally practiced a lot, and I actually upsolved all the problems that I couldn't solve and learned new techniques always. Like I was open to learning. So it shouldn't be like I already know this much, I shouldn't learn anymore. So you should always be open to learning.
Okay, that's so cool. I mean, how much C++ or any language you need to know to be a good coder? Like, I mean, how much STL you need to know or something?
Yeah, so thing is that like in C++, you get like any language, you get certain libraries like the STL in C++, where you get certain functionalities like maps and set, which are essentially some data structures implemented. Mm-hmm. So if you know those things, then it might help in some problems. However, the thing that matters is data structure, having a knowledge about data structure and algorithm.
Mm-hmm.
So like C++ language doesn't play a very crucial role. However, in some problems, like language will be kind of a tool that you can use to like give your work. If you're using C, then you have to build those things on yourself. But then, unless you're
able to... your voice is low again.
That's
good.
Yeah, cool. So thing is, what I'm trying to say is C++ is just a tool. A language, any language is just a tool. It's not like if you know a language, you are good enough to just do CP. So you can use the tools to build your solution. Like first thing is you have to frame a logic, right? So logic is much more important than these tools. So if you are able to build a logic, then you can even use C to actually code. But then in C, you have to do a lot of stuff like write your own data structures and stuff. So that's actually will be pretty hectic for you. That's why people prefer using C++ or Java or Python.
Okay.
I guess that makes sense.
Yeah. One question from Golapali Rupa is, so I'll take this question. The question is, she is from NIT Trichy, civil engineering, and most companies don't open for us. So I have decent experience with continuity coding. What should people expect like me to do? Okay, so one thing that you can do is again having a good profile somewhere. Like let's say you are a 6-star coder, code chef, or you have very good projects on GitHub. So those things will help you to get the interview call. Your branch doesn't matter that much if you have all the knowledge of coding and all the knowledge of CS fundamentals like OS, networking, DBMS, then you are, you know, good to get a job. So my question to you, Shoham, is like how someone can get an interview call for off campus, being from a third year college or being from a non-CS background?
So one of the most like you should have a very good LinkedIn profile, I guess, because through LinkedIn, they're like LinkedIn is kind of a place like a social hub for recruiters and students. Like it's a place where people can get to know students can get to know recruiters, and recruiters can get to find like students who are like would be good enough for the role. So mm-hmm. having a good LinkedIn profile is obviously very important. Like I myself like I didn't apply for Shopee myself. The recruiter contacted me because my profile was good. So in fact I also got I was contacted by another company.
Sorry, Swam, can you describe like and how do you define a good profile on LinkedIn? Like what are the things that
thing is that anything that you have done, like if you feel it's a good thing that you have done, mm-hmm. then it should be on your LinkedIn profile. Like say I have been to SMICBC twice, and that
right.
That actually means that I have been one of the not the best, but one of the best coders from my college. That's why I am able to reach there, right?
Yeah.
So that's why I wrote that I am in ACM ICPC. I have been to ACM ICPC twice.
Mm-hmm.
Then I have interned with DHO India, which is kind of my experience. I gained some experience out of that, and people look for experienced folks. So that's why that I put that up. Like I have written DHO, SWE intern at DHO, then ACM ICPC regionally 2017 and 2019. Also, I have a 6-star coder. I am a 6-star at CodeChef, so I have also written that 6-star at CodeChef. Now, suppose you have very nice projects, you should also include them in your project section. There is a project section in GitHub as well,
mm-hmm.
so you should include them. So any work experience you have, any achievement, you may also make sure that if you have some achievement, like maybe you secured a rank of maybe top 100 or top 200 in Kickstart. So you should actually write that, like you should make a post that I secured rank of 200 in Kickstart. So
mm-hmm.
that's so that people actually get to know that you are good. So in this way, they can actually identify between like people who are actually like whom they would consider for their profiles. So once you are identified by a recruiter, then the recruiter can directly like contact you, and also you can actually contact the recruiters or any, like suppose you want to apply for a company. Like what I did for media.net was Raj got into media.net, so after
mm-hmm.
that I was also thinking that I should try for media.net as well. So what I did was I searched for media.net in LinkedIn, and there I found the list of people who are actually working in media.net. So in this way, actually I reached to one of them and said, hey, I'm currently in my final year, and then would you like to give me a referral? I have this is my profile, this is my CV. So he also saw that my profile was promising and I might get a job as well. So he also referred me into media.net, and that's how it works. Like you can reach out to people, you can reach out to recruiters, you can reach out to people from people working in that office so that you can get a referral. So the process becomes a bit easy, and recruiters can also reach you. Like the process might be vice versa. So that's how it works. So having a good profile is very important. Like you should actually focus on building your profile properly with in LinkedIn.
Yes. And I think being a great competitive coder will help you to make your profile better. And if you are contributing to open source, that also will help you to add something to your profile. And apart from LinkedIn, you can create your profile on other websites like Nokia.com, Shine.com, Indeed, Hirist, Instar. Suppose you can get a call from these websites as well. So having profile everywhere will help you to get the interview calls easily. Now the next question from Soham is, is having a project compulsory to get the internship?
It's not compulsory, like it's completely based on which company we're applying for. So I'll tell you my experience that I was actually working on competitive programming for the entire second year, right? So I didn't have a single project. I had projects, but they were mostly like image processing based, like deep learning,
mm-hmm.
building neural networks. So I wasn't very comfortable with that topic. Like I knew that if I place the project, I can tell about my project, but then if they ask something else, like about some, they might ask something that I don't know. So I wasn't very comfortable. So on the first day, there was a campus pool of Code Nation, and then three of us got shortlisted for the campus pool. And then the recruiter called me up at 10 a.m. and said to ask me that you will be having your round at 10:30 from 10:30 a.m. And so I was okay with that. So we had our round, and the first question he asked was, tell me about yourself. And I was actually so afraid, like I wasn't prepared for that round.
Okay.
I just woke up from sleep, and I'm getting a call that you will be having an interview in next 30 minutes. And then the next thing he's asking is, tell me about yourself. So I thought he's genuinely asking about myself. So I started telling about myself. But that's tell me about myself means tell me about your projects. I realized that later. So I was so much afraid that I was also underconfident. So I forgot to mention, I didn't mention about my projects at all. Then that was a very big setback, and I wasn't proceeded for the further rounds. Like that was the last round zero, and I like barely they cut off someone at round zero after tell me about yourself. So but then they eventually didn't hire anyone from our college because that was a campus pool. Then the next company that visited was DHO, and there I made sure that I like was able to explain my projects properly. So in the first round we had a discussion about 20 long minutes about my project. and then he placed one or two DS Algo questions. So obviously having a project kills up your time as well. So if so he already knows that you have worked on something, so you, and you are also able to explain it. That's why, that means that you have an understanding of what you have done. So that actually helps, because in their companies also you have to actually work on some projects, right? So you should have a proper, like you should do it properly. So they, by your projects, they know that you are able to work. Something okay. like that.
Interesting. The next question, I'll take this question. So question is from Abhi. How is it, how is work in product-based companies? Is it related on DSLGO, whether they use framework like in services company? Yes, I mean, like I work in Paytm and Adobe. So of course they use a framework like, so I was in backend. So we were using Java, Spring Boot, Hibernate, these things. And frontend guy use React or AngularJS or Backbone.js for the frontend. So yes, I mean, they use the frameworks. Yeah, so the next question for Soham is, so can you describe some, like how someone should start from first year till the fourth year? I mean, what should be the complete path to, you know, get a good job from campus?
Sure. So thing is, in campus actually the competition is much less, mm-hmm. because when you are applying for off campus, everyone in the, like all around India, many people are applying, so the competition is much more. Right. So it's the easiest way out is getting a job on campus itself. So I would suggest you, if you're in first year or second year, you should work a bit on CP. Like, you don't have to be a great in CP, but like being good enough is okay, because such that you can, like if you get some question that you don't know beforehand, then you can actually think about that and solve it upfront. So I all the interviews I faced till now, I never got a question that was common, like I did it before, but I was able to solve them, most of them. So something like that. Also you can work on some projects as well, because projects also helps in killing time during the interviews. Then I would suggest that, like, these two are enough, I guess. Like, you should also have a good understanding of CS fundamentals. Like, for internship, they don't actually look for you, like, they don't actually need you to know OS, DBMS properly, like, the networks properly. But then it's always better, like, you should have some understanding of DBMS and OS as well. So that will obviously help you and add to your, like, strengths. But then otherwise, these things are enough, and a few months practice prior to your interviews, like maybe one or, if you're good with CP, then you can actually practice for 1 or 2 months from Geeks for Geeks, and then you can actually, like, you might get some common questions as well. So who wouldn't want that, right?
Okay. One question from Akash is, can anyone doing a job not in college can appear in ACM/ICPC? I think no.
So only college students are allowed to participate.
But you can try other competition, like you can try the CodeShift Long Challenge, the CodeForce, the top coders.
No, so if you are looking for proper challenges, you can go for CodeShift Snackdown, which right. is a very good challenge.
Mm-hmm.
There is CodeJam, Google CodeJam, there is
yes.
Google Kickstart, there is Facebook Hacker Cup. You can actually go for those competitions as well. They are pretty prestigious and pretty good competitions.
Yes. So how to select a good project to work upon?
That depends, like, what you're working on. So you can actually, like, it shouldn't be like any project which you can actually explain for 20 to 30 minutes is a good project, right? So you should actually, like, if you're maybe, say I was working on image processing and stuff, so obviously I actually explained them, like, so when you explain a project to an interviewer, you should be like, you should be explaining it in such a way that you should expect that he doesn't know anything, and he doesn't know anything about like that project, and you should start from the base and then explain. So I actually explained him what CNNs are, how they work, and what are the different layers, convolutional layers, pooling layers and stuff. And then I gradually went into my project, what I did actually. So anything that will help you kill your time, like if you have a, if you build some web application or so, you can actually use some optimization techniques, like maybe sharding your databases or so, and then explain why you are sharding your database or why you are using microservice, or maybe you are not using a microservice architecture, but then you can use something like maybe some, you might have written your own algorithms maybe for something, so you are explaining that as well. So anything that you can kill your time with, so is a good project, I guess.
I just want to add a few more points. So the thing is, I mean, if you are interested in front end, then you can learn some front end thing and build something by yourself? Let's say you are interested in backend, then you just can learn backend framework
Yeah,
like.
so I would like to add one thing. So what he said was actually very true. If you're working with front end, then you actually have a proof like what you have done. So you can actually show them that product, your product, you can showcase your product, right? So that's a very plus point, I guess.
In fact, I'm working on front end. I guess it's easier than working on something like big data or backend thing.
Yeah, backend is easy, but then big data and stuff are like might be
Yes.
overwhelming a bit.
Right.
But yeah, so
I mean, it depends on your
like
interest. Like, if you think that Android is cool, then you can do some Android development. If you think that AI/ML is cool, then you can go in that domain. Or if you think that DevOps is good, then you can simply do something in that domain. So it's totally up to you. Nothing is important or less important. It's totally up to your choice, and everything will be given the equal weightage, I guess. I mean, for
yeah.
at least for the on-campus placement. One question from Hemant Kumar is working in startups a good choice? Yes, I mean, in work, so working in a startup will teach you a lot of things, because in a startup you will be working on multiple things, and you will be implementing things from scratch. Like when I was in Paytm, so I have done a really interesting work in Paytm, because we implemented a lot of things from scratch. But if you join a bigger company, then you will be working on already inbuilt things mainly. Of course, you will be given chance to implement something from scratch, but that's only rare. And in a startup, you will be working on multiple things. Like, the same backend guy might be working on the front end, might be working on the DevOps or security or DBA. So multiple roles will help you to learn a lot of things. So I think that, of course, I mean, if you can start, I mean, your career with a startup, that's a good thing to learn. So anything that you want to add?
Yeah, sure. So I actually completely agree with you because I think the best thing that you can do is start your career with a startup and then actually switch to a like stable companies, like big companies, maybe FAANG, something like that. But then with startups, what you get to learn, you get a lot of exposure because what happens is you have to work on a lot of things together because the teams are small. So everyone has a lot of weight over them. Like if you're working for say a company X maybe, and then it's a very big company, there are a lot of people working. So they'll give you, and it's already a very developed company, so they'll give you a small project to work on, maybe a part of what they have built, and you'll get to like maybe like very small project. Like you won't be able to, you won't be like involved in building the entire application as well. So I luckily got the chance to build a full stack application. But then there are many of my friends who just built maybe sub modules or something like that. But then it's obviously like one of my friends is working for CodeChef, and then he actually tells that he got to learn a lot. He got like he is actually given jobs that are actually not given to interns. So he got to actually learn a lot about systems and stuff. So I think it's a very good thing that you can start your career with a startup. So that way you can, like, this is the age you should learn, right? So once you are like old enough, it's like you're learning, like it will obviously decrease like your tendency to learn new things. But this is the time you should be focusing on learning new stuffs. So I think starting your career in a startup is a very good thing that you can do.
Great. So now can you share your Shopee Singapore interview?
Yeah, sure. So for Shopee, like many people actually reached out to me that how I got the referral also. But to be clear, I didn't get any referral. The recruiter Gabriel actually contacted me over LinkedIn. So I had a decent LinkedIn
Can you check your
profile.
voice?
Yes, sure. Hello.
Yeah,
Am
not
I
good,
audible?
not
Yeah.
good.
Okay. Cool. So Gabriel actually contacted me over LinkedIn, and he just asked me like one day he asked me, "Hey, Soham, would you like to work for Shopee Singapore?" And I said, "Of course. Like, who would miss an international offer, right?" So then I had an online round, and in the online round, there was like one coding question and a few MCQs on C++, I guess, and some of the DBMS and OS. So I did decently and got shortlisted for the next round. Also, one thing that you should do is like they are using glider, and in glider it is pretty like you shouldn't do any form of wrong activities. Like you shouldn't like take your phone into your screen because there's a tracker which actually tracks. Like if you bring your phone in the screen, it will give a red marker. So I was like, you shouldn't do it. Like in any like whenever you are sitting for any company, you shouldn't actually you should keep your phone at a pretty nice distance because like you shouldn't get blacklisted by that company. That you should take care of. So then that happened. Then I got shortlisted for the next round. So the first technical round, in my first technical round, I was asked a DSLGO question, which I completed within maybe 10 minutes. And then he focused on some DBMS, like he gave me some SQL queries to write. I did them as well, and then he asked some DBMS questions, and then my first round was done. Then after a week, I had my second round and the third round on the same day. So they said that if you do well enough for the second round, we'll be having a third round on the same day itself. So in my second round, I was asked three DSLGO questions. And thing is that's the interesting part that you can't actually expect that you will get something from certain topics only because I was asked a question which was on flows, which I also solved. That like I was like luckily able to solve that. It was a bipartite matching question, not bipartite matching, but a maximum matching question. And then I was also asked some questions on ternary search, a question on ternary search and one question on binary search. And then he moved into OS. He asked me a few questions on OS because after three questions already, it was already 1 hour or so, and the interview was for 1 hour 30 minutes. So he could only ask a few questions on OS that I answered them, and then they told informed me that I moved to the next round. For the final round, it was with my team leader, and then he asked me a system design based question, and I was able to answer it properly, and he was very happy with it as well. So then, yeah, then he at the end of the interview, he asked me, "But why wouldn't you like to like? Is there a reason you would reject us?" I said, "No, obviously there's no such reason." So I would have an offer from you. Then it went very good, and then after like it was a Friday, so Saturday Sunday they took time to decide. Like Saturday Sunday actually they're closed, so they couldn't call me that time. So on Monday they informed me that I got the offer, and they told me all the details. Yeah, so that happened.
Okay, I'll come to details sometime later. Before that, I just want to pick one question, and I think I can answer this question. The question is, I got placed in a service-based company. How can I upgrade to a product-based company? Okay, so the first thing, Ankur, Chun, you should do is you should master the DSLGO skill and the LLM skill, because I mean these are the most time skills to crack those interviews. So once you are done with these things, you can simply again you can try to reach the recruiters through LinkedIn, or you can make a profile on other websites like Naukri.com, Indeed, InstaHire, and you will I mean you can easily get interview call from those companies. In fact, you can ask for the referrals. Let's say you want to join Amazon, so you can simply approach someone who is already working there, and you can ask for the referrals, and he or she might refer you. In that case, you can get the interview call, and now it's your turn to crack those interview. So the first thing is master all the skills that is required, and you can start preparation from Geeks or Geeks. So on Geeks or Geeks, you can find the interview experiences of all these companies like Amazon, Microsoft, Adobe, or Flipkart, or you know all these companies. And let's say your experience is 3 years or 4 years, then also we have experience for candidates having more experience, so you can go through them to know the interview pattern and the questions they ask, like how much you should focus on design thing, how much you should focus on the CS fundamentals, and again how much you should focus on coding, and what are the topics on which they can ask the questions. So once you are prepared, then you can simply try to get the interview call, and then if you are good at those things, you can crack those interviews easily. So this is the way to get into the product-based companies from a service-based company. So that's the path you can follow. Okay, so the next question from Soham is, so let's say someone is in fourth semester, so is he too
Sorry,
late?
I didn't catch you.
Yeah, sorry.
Sorry, I didn't catch you.
Okay, so the question from Akhil is, he is in fourth semester,
Okay.
is he too late to start CP?
to start computer programming?
Yes.
Okay, so so it depends completely like what you are want, like what you want to do. If you are preparing for your interviews, I would suggest you to go to sites like GeekSolve and practice, because this time building, like learning lot of stuff is will be overwhelming for you, and you will be having your interview, like campus interviews or something like that. If you are looking for internships, then you will be having them within some time, like maybe 2-3 months maybe. So I think what you should focus on right now is like going to such like GeekSolve and practice problems, and also looking through interview experiences. But if you are just, if you want to learn CP, like if you want to directly apply for FTEs and stuff, like you have some time, approximately 1 year, then you can actually start with competitive programming right now as well. And you should like try your best, like learn as much as you can. And while learning, you can actually see that you will be improving, like you'll see an improvement within maybe 3-4 months, and then within a year you'll be like great, like you'll be doing great. So that's like it's completely up to you what you want to do, what you want to, what do you want, why do you want to learn CP. Like if you want to learn it first, like if you want to learn competitive programming, then you can start right now as well, but it will take some time. If you're doing it for placements like internships and stuff, then you should go to GeekSolve and solve problem.
Okay, so for DP questions, I mean is it necessary to write, I mean, know like how to write the memoization and the tabulation both, or only knowing tabulation is enough?
So one thing that people I found many people doing is like thinking DP as a, like whenever they start with a DP problem, they build a table and try formulating some solutions. That's not how you should actually approach a DP question. Mm-hmm. Instead, what you should focus on is writing the recurrence relations. So mm-hmm. if you are not good at writing recurrences, then DP isn't for you. So what you need to do is you should focus much more on writing recurrences. Just solve as many problems as you can, try forming the recurrence relations on your own. Once you're comfortable with writing the recurrences, you can just memorize it and it's just DP. Like you get, you don't have to focus it whether it's top down, it's bottom up. Once you are memorizing like both, yeah, there is a performance difference, like when you are recursively doing it and you are iteratively doing it. But then for now, what you need to care about is like just forming recurrence relations. Once you are good with that, like it's not a big deal just to convert from top down to bottom up and vice versa. So just try building recurrence relations. I
okay.
would suggest you to work on that.
Okay, great. Again, one question is, I mean, how CP has helped you to crack your Disha or Shopee interview?
So CP has actually helped me, like CP is everything that I did, right? So kind of everything that I did. So before the show interview, I didn't have, like I had projects, but then what I did more was I focused on CP. So eventually CP helped me to crack the show interview. But then like it didn't completely help me, but CS fund, they were, I was asked CS fundamentals, I was asked about projects as well. So having a good project plus CP is definitely very helpful. But then there are many companies that focus only on CP. They won't be asking you much on your projects, like Microsoft, Amazon, Google. They generally don't ask you much on your projects as well. So they only ask you data structures and algorithms mostly. So it's obviously very, like, it obviously helped me a lot. Like in Shopee as well, as I said, like the questions were pretty standard, the DS Algo questions. And you can't like expect people to solve flow problems in an interview. So really that was like, because I practiced CP like a lot, so I was able to think of it in a graphical way as well. Like I was initially going for a greedy approach, then I realized that it wouldn't work, and I quickly changed. I just made some graphs and saw that okay, it's actually matching problems. So that's how I did it, because it was completely because I did it for a long time, and it's kind of now inbuilt in me. Like I can actually think like that. So once you practice a lot, practice not a lot but quite enough, like good enough. Mm-hmm. It will obviously be very helpful in tracking your interviews, and it was helpful in my case as well.
Okay. And one more thing that I want to announce is, so we have courses for DS Algo. If you want to start from beginning, then you can join that course. We have a course on CP as well. And if you want to do some projects, then we just launched a course on React.js, which is the best framework for front-end development. So if you want to do some front-end thing, you can join that course, and Soham will be there as instructor.
I'll
in that.
A mentor. We both will be the mentor actually.
Yes. Yeah. We have shared the link of our courses page, so you can explore that course. And in this carnival week, you can find a lot of discount on the courses, so it's the best time to purchase those courses, right? Okay, so we are going out, running out of time, so I'll take two or three more questions. Okay, the one question is regarding Placement 100 course. So someone is doing already the Placement 100 course. What should I do? Competitive programming, learn the development or like. Oh, Pratik, I got your question. So to crack the interviews of these companies like Amazon or Google or other top companies, you should be good at DS Algo mainly, and you should know the CS fundamentals like operating system, networking, and DBMS, and you should have at least one or two projects that you can write on your resume. And in fact, they might ask you questions on those things. So these things are enough to crack the interviews. So it's not compulsory to learn AI, ML, or web development. It's just that you should have something to write on your resume. So it could be anything. It could be web development. It could be backend. It could be AI, ML. It could be image processing. It could be Android. Anything. That is, I mean, all have equal weightage. Okay. The one question is. I mean, what do you think for on-campus or off-campus placements or freshers, for internship or for full-time job? I mean, how much important is, I mean, what is the weightage of projects? What do you think?
So as I said, like there will be companies that will be focusing a lot on projects. Like as I said, I was rejected in first round for coordination, round zero for coordination because I didn't mention my projects. But then in DISH also, I had to like most people, like all my co, like those who got shortlisted for the second round or for the interviews, most of them were rejected. Some of them were rejected because they didn't have any projects. So I think having a projects is obviously very important. Like it's not, but like it depends on the companies you're applying for. Like if you're applying for Google or Microsoft or Amazon, then projects isn't very important. Like they won't ask you about your projects sometimes. So they'll just focus on asking you DS Algo questions. But then if you're applying for certain other companies, then they will also focus on your projects. So having a project is obviously a very good thing that you can do. So it's always safe to have projects, I would say.
Okay, so one question from Praveen Chauhan, who's a very active user of Geeks for Geeks YouTube channel. So his question is, would like to know first year, second year, third year, and fourth year coverage of concepts, like what you should learn in first year, then second year, and third year, and
Okay, sure. So in first year and second year, I think like as you're starting your college life, so I think you can focus more on competitive programming, because then once you're strengthened with DS and Algo, then in your second, like towards the end of your second year, you'll be, if you're having your campus placements, you can work on like, you can study from Geeks for Geeks and stuff like about DS Algo, certain things that you might not know. And also you can actually study a bit about DBMS OS. In your third year, I would suggest you to study a lot. Like you should study on your computer fundamentals, like computer networks, OS and DBMS. You should be very strong with them. Like you should be very well equipped with them, because like you can expect in FTE people will be asking you questions from them. So but in internships, yeah, there's a like in internships generally people don't ask from those parts, because they know that you might not know that like we had our OS in our fifth semester and DBMS and networks in sixth semester. So obviously it wasn't possible for us to know. But then it's obviously good for you to know. But then for first and second year, you can focus on competitive programming, and then you can switch to learning computer fundamentals, system design, and also doing some development as well on the go.
Okay. One question from Arpan Datta is, projects should be on AI, ML, Android, or C, C++ projects are also considered? Yes, any project is considered, right? It could be on anything. It could be in C++, Java, it could be on MATLAB as well. That will be
MATLAB
considered.
is kind of AI again. But then thing is, as long as you're able to explain, kill some time with it, it's good enough. Like it shouldn't be like you are writing us, so like what I would say, like maybe a tic-tac-toe game or something like that. That's not so just make something that you can kill at least 20 minutes about time. So that would do.
One question from D'Souza is funny question. Sorry. Okay, so the question is, does being from MSc IT background make a difference for jobs? No, so I personally know a lot of people. They are from MCA, MS, and they're from different backgrounds. Some of them were from MS in mathematics. Still, they were working in Adobe, right? So your degree will not matter at all, I think. So college matters for starting 2 or 3 years, but degree I don't think so, because you will find MSc and MCA guys will be working with you. A lot of them will be working with you, so it won't make a difference. Your college name might make a difference for starting few years, because that's how you get the interview call. But after that, it will not matter at all. Okay, so the one interesting question is, I mean, how tough it is to get a job through off campus?
It's actually very tough. Like, first of all, you have to get yourself noticed, right? So you can't just go to someone and tell, hey, I am graduating this year. Can I get a referral? They won't give you. Like, you should have a promising CV, because thing is that you have to understand their point of view as well. Like, if they refer you and then you turn out like not to be a very good candidate, then their name is at risk. Right, so actually you should have a very good profile, so you should focus on building your profile. Then people will be noticing you. Like, people might come to you, or you might go to people and they'll agree to give you referrals. And after that, you should realize that, like, it's obviously the company won't be taking like all of you, right? So they will be having, like, say they are hiring a lot right now, so they are in the peak hiring period, so you can expect them to be hiring 500 candidates, right? So but 500 candidate, but you can expect that number of applicants are around 10,000. So you have to be good, like you have to be in the best 500 among the 10,000. So you actually have to be very working very hard to actually crack out off campus now interview.
Okay. So can you share some tips and tricks that will help someone to crack the internship or full-time interviews?
Yeah, sure. So thing is that what I've realized is till now is being strong with TSN Algo is must. Like, if you want to crack an interview, you should be strong with TSN Algo. Like, and then you should have some projects as well, a decent projects with which you can kill your time in certain interviews if they're asking about your projects. Also, you should have like your fundamentals, like computer science fundamentals, should be pretty clear. Like, they'll be taught to you in college itself, and that time you can learn it properly. Then by that only your fundamentals will mostly be clear. Also, you should learn certain extra stuffs like system design and stuff, which is not actually taught in colleges. So you should actually spend some time on that as well. So with these things, I guess it's like you can clear most of the interviews. But then the most important thing will always be TSN Algo, because almost all companies will be focusing on that.
Okay, one question from Shailendra is, so I'll take that question. The question is, what should be the path of a 6 years experienced guy with C hash background? Please take that away. Okay, so again, if you want to join the top tech companies, then you must know the DSL. You should be good at coding things, right? Then only you'll be able to crack the first 2 or 3 coding rounds, right? And then again, you should know the design thing, LLD and HLD. Apart from that, you should be good in your domain. Let's say you are a backend developer, then you should know the backend stuff, like how exactly a load balancer works, I mean, what's the difference between NoSQL and MySQL, and how to design a cache, how to I mean, how to use a messaging queue to implement something, or how to make something asynchronous. So all these things are important. It depends on your background, your work. So you should be good at your domain as well. And once you are done with the preparation, then you can start applying in those companies through LinkedIn or through any other website. So that should be the path. Okay, so now the last question from Soham is, okay, again, the one question was, I mean, like, how helpful is being a code, being 6-star coder at CodeShift?
So it's actually pretty helpful, because like, you can actually put in your profile that you are 6-star coder, and then people will know that you are actually good with TSN Algo. Also, 6-star like being a six star actually makes you good with TSL Algo by default, right? So you don't actually have to prepare like that much, I would say, for your company interviews. Whenever it comes, like on TSL Algo, you can focus on other stuffs. Like what I did in Shopee was I didn't actually prepare anything from TSL Algo. Rather, I focused on computer fundamentals and system design more, because I knew that this would actually make some difference, because I was like pretty confident about my TSL Algo skills. But then it's obviously like it's very good to be like, it's also an addition to your CV, right? And yeah, those things help, like CV, LinkedIn profile, and as well as you are already good with TSL Algo will help you crack the interviews.
Great. One question from Rohan is, Shashi sir, I'm doing Placement 100 course for placement preparation in third year. Yeah, that's good. I mean, it will help you to crack your internship interviews and full-time interviews. Okay, so this will be last question for Shoham. Okay, so can you share your projects, like, I mean, that will help them to decide the domain?
Sure. So actually I can't share the exact details, because they are kind of research based projects that I'm working on in my college.
Interesting.
And so I can't just like tell them the detail. But mostly what I have found people are, what I have done is I have worked on image processing, so mostly segmentation and stuff, like image segmentation, localization. So those things you can try it out. And then I have seen people working on NLP and stuff as well. So you can, like, that's a very like machine learning and deep learning is a very vast field. You can try exploring that. But then you can also try some small projects as well, like building maybe some websites or so, like a full stack web application maybe. And that actually uses some nice algorithm in backend. Then that you can like spend some time explaining like how you designed it, why you like made such a design, like why you used a particular database. Like as he said, you should like you used maybe NoSQL database, why you used that, why not MySQL. Then you should actually like make some projects that where you can actually spend some time on the design part as well. And as well as if you have some algorithms there, then it's very good. Like you can also spend some time discussing the algorithm what you used.
Okay. The one question from Tulsi Jha is, can you tell me, does academic marks matter for internship or full-time job? Okay, so I think it's only for your cutoff mark for the, you know, placements.
Yeah, but yeah, it matters. Like I won't say it doesn't matter at all, but then if you're good enough, it will not matter. But then like if you have a competition, like if they feel that two of you are of same potential, then they will obviously consider into the fact that they'll obviously give a 9-pointer more preference over a 7-pointer. But then I myself have a 8-point, I'm also 8-pointer, so I'm not a 9-pointer as well. So in that case, yeah, it doesn't actually matter that much. But if you're good enough, it will not matter. But then having a good CGPA obviously will help.
And again, I know someone who is a 7-pointer and who is working in Amazon. So I mean,
obviously.
For off campus and for lateral hiring, these things will not matter at all. So
yeah,
don't worry about those things. For on campus placement, I mean, these things can matter. Like your college will have a cutoff. Then of course you should, your CGPA should be more than that. Then only you'll be eligible to you know, sit in the rounds. So you can simply maintain a decent CGPA.
Yeah. Having a decent CGPA, like having a 7.5 to 8 CGPA is decent.
Yes.
You can obviously maintain that. That's not a big deal. Also, make sure that you don't have backlogs, because I have seen Microsoft actually reject many people because of backlogs. So make sure of that.
So one question for you is, what's your ultimate goal that you want to reach?
What is my... that's interesting, actually. So I can say that actually I have always fascinated working for Google, not Google India, but Google some, like maybe abroad, maybe Munich or maybe Google Singapore or so. So that's actually, I think, when, like, I'll obviously my focus still remains that, and I'll work hard, and maybe if I reach there, then maybe, like, it's completely relative, right? So once you reach there, you might have other goals as well, but for now it's kind of that, like some Google offshore offer. Yeah.
That's interesting. Okay. Okay, so this is the last question of this evening. Okay. Last question is, I mean, how important is mathematics and puzzles to crack the interviews?
Pretty interesting question. See, mathematics, a basic knowledge of mathematics, like being good with mathematics, is obviously very helpful. But then it's not a mandatory, like you can always learn stuff again. Like you don't, like it's not like when you learn some algorithm, it's not always maths, but then there are certain algorithms which actually rely a lot on maths. So, but then most of them, those questions aren't asked in interviews, like FFK and TT won't be asked in interviews. So mathematics is not very important, but then being good in mathematics actually will always help you.
Okay. Yes. Okay. I'll take this last question. The question is it possible to get a full-time job without a degree? Yes. I mean, if your skills are really excellent, then you can get a job. In fact, recruiters will contact you. Let's say you are a 6-star or 7-star at Code Chef, or you have done something amazing and that is on web. I mean, that is on GitHub. Or if you've done something really interesting, of course, recruiters will call you to offer you a job. So you can get a job without having a full degree. Yeah. So any last note from your side, so anything that you want to share with the college students?
I think if you're from, like, if you're in your first and second year, I'm also educating for them. So it's time that, yeah, it's like, it sounds, you might find it interesting that you are spending a lot of time on stuff like web development, and I'm not saying that it's bad, it's obviously very good, you should do that, but then you should also focus a bit on competitive programming as well. Like many of people, I found many people saying that competitive programming is not of any use and stuff, so that's actually completely not true. If you want to land in a tech giant or something,
can you check your voice? It's low.
Okay, so what I'm trying to say is don't completely ignore competitive programming. Because eventually, like, it's okay that you are doing some projects on web development, on machine learning, it's cool, like, it's very good. I'm not saying don't do that, do that, but also find some time for competitive programming and stuff as well, because, like, they will help you eventually in cracking the interviews, right? If you want to land in a tech giant, then obviously those skills are very important. But then, like, yeah, you can, like, then prioritize, like, what you want to do, it's completely up to you, but don't live in a dilemma, like, if I'm not good with CP, I can get anywhere, because that might not be the case. Unless you're very, very good at what you are doing, CP will always be helping you.
Okay.
That's what I would like to say. So, yeah, so just focus on CP as well. Don't do that.
Okay, great. So, thanks, Swam. I hope your answers have helped a lot of college students.
Yeah. I also hope.
Yeah. And you guys can ask your questions in the comment sections. Soham or I will be replying your answers there, right? And you can find the LinkedIn profile of Soham and you can contact him directly as well. You can ping him on LinkedIn. He will be
sure.
replying.
Sure,
yeah. So thank you. Thank you for attending us.
Yeah, sure. Thank you for calling. Yeah, sure.
Thanks. Okay.